different. So no need to tell the pilot. Amy's another one of New Zealand's navigators. Wrote this out pretty well at the commission.
If I had seen Captain Collins that morning, I probably would have just said to him, even in passing, "Well, Jim, a couple of miles change, it won't make any difference to the process." Nobody knows if there's a 27 mile change.
That last part is crucial. Air New Zealand's entire explanation for how this mistake happened is that nobody realised that the 2.5 mile change was actually a type of 7 mile change. If they had known, it would have been unforgivable not to tell the pilot. What's going on? Justice Moore has written a remarkable testament of errors. And he was right. In one excruciating exchange, Paul Davison, the lawyer for the estate of Jim Collins, took Brian Hewitt through all of the mistakes one by one. This is a recreation from a TV documentary.
He told us you inadvertently pushed the wrong key. You agree that was an error or an issue?
That was an error.
Followed by your testing. You see, the error in the Mikado position. That was an error, was it not?
That was an omission.
Indeed, errors. Well, a company within its nav section tells us we are dealing with people who check and cross-check and never have done anything. Well, it's true, isn't it?
That's
the
story.
I suggest to you, whose job it is to be precise,
that is your opinion.
Now, if things were already pretty bad between New Zealand management and the pilot, this is the point in the connection that completely fell apart. By now, it was late November 1980.
What that means for me is
the evidence about that infamous breach 3 weeks before the crash. That was the one where Liz Simpson said she had a route to the captain's flight was down in the middle of Longmeadow Town. Other two surviving pilots who attended said the same.
The men who ran the briefing,
Ross Johnson and John Wilson, who we mentioned earlier, they said no. Definitely told the pilot that the route went over Mount Erebus. John Wilson was unequivocal on this point.
There's no time that I say anything other than the aircraft and the flight to Erebus.
Both sides couldn't be right. Liz Simpson had a theory about why this was. He and the other pilots only heard the briefing once. Johnson and Wilson gave it several times.
Possibly, unconsciously, they demonstrated they inadvertently improved.
Simpson was saying that it wasn't that Wilson and Johnson were lying, or that they convinced themselves that they're thinking if they hadn't. Wilson's evidence, Simpson said, he didn't have a massive problem with. Johnson's evidence, however,
for the sick guy who had in this court, was so different from my recital that I wondered if, in fact, I had attended the same week.
From here on, it was pretty much a battle drawn between Air New Zealand management and the union. Justice Mann called it the same possibility. It was about that time that he met the Air New Zealand lawyer in his chambers. He asked his concerns that some of the airline's evidence was looking a bit sketchy, a decision that would cost him dearly.
Arthur Cooper was also bothered by what he heard. Remember, Cooper was a union guy, Clay Collins, but he is from a New Zealand employee, and he had no desire to see the company become a laughing stock. In case for the union, they were getting, as they practiced, to become a bit of a joke. Cooper and the colleagues decided to go and see their boss, Chief Executive Maurie Davis. And also suggests that he sends someone to attend a hearing every day to see David updated.
He's told me that.
Of course, yes, he's able to see that that's how that he's so disguised or so best.
He's done the things that he's done very well.
Cooper thought Davis was hinting at just how hard it's safe for him. Air New Zealand was a government-owned airline, and it could not have cost a whole lot of money if it ended up taking a rap at a crash. That was why Davis wasn't interested in what he had to say. After 40 minutes,
I'm not expecting
to be
there.
And I think it's too bright back at my
place. Yeah. Like an atmosphere.
said, looking at David, is like looking down the barrel of a gun. So when the chief executive took the stand as the very last witness of the commission, he dug his gun and delivered an impassioned defense of the company that had worked for since he was 16.
Thank you.
360 to 300.
Down the middle of McMurdo South.
Physically, I'm seeing two men standing in hospital like a mountain with your own eyes.